Hello, and welcome once again to a Beatles podcast show, which we call Things We Said Today. This is a bi-weekly program in which we talk about anything that has to do with the Beatles. Could be about their years together, the solo years, their history, their music, what's going on in the news, which we do in virtually all of our shows now. Anything that comes to mind, we can cover here on the show. I'm Ken Michaels. I'm one of the three regular co-hosts of the show. Hopefully you know me from my syndicated Beatles program called Every Little Thing, and also another podcast show on the Beatles' solo years and recordings called Talk More Talk. And I'm being joined by my two other co-hosts. First of all, our resident musicologist, who has authored a number of Beatle books, including Got That Something, How the Beatles, I Want to Hold Your Hand, Changed Everything, and The Beatles from the Cavern to the Rooftop, and that's Alan Kozinn. Hi, Alan.
Hello, Ken. Hello, everyone.
And also we have a veteran DJ in New York who has been on WFUV for 30-plus years, and he's their Beatle guy there at the station, and that's Darren DeVivo. Hi, Darren.
Howdy, everyone.
We have a special guest with us this time. This is someone that I've had the privilege of knowing for a few years now. I first came to the attention of this guy because he was actually doing a Ringo Starr tribute show at, was it the Cutting Room, John?
It was the Cutting Room, yes.
Yeah, all Ringo music. I never heard anybody do all Ringo in a concert.
Yeah.
He plays the bass, he plays guitar, he also plays keyboards and drums, and he has quite a resume to talk about, because he spent, was it 7 years, you told me, with Alan Parsons?
Oh, 7 years.
Okay.
That's correct.
And in addition to that, if you're familiar with the Happy Together tours, he's been in the house band for those shows.
That's right.
Also, way back in the early 2000s, there was a tour called The Walk Down Abbey Road, for which there were two tours, I believe. Were there two, John?
There were two full-length tours.
Right.
And then after that, I think we just did a couple of one-offs. That's when I came in. The first one, it was basically an all-star. It was Walk Down Abbey Road. It was an all-star Beatles tribute. There was going to be sort of a loose Beatles theme, artists sort of connected to the Beatles. And then I think they dispensed with that. It was Alan Parsons, Todd Rundgren, Ann Wilson from Heart, David Pack from Ambrosia. And the bassist was John Entwistle on that first one. The following year, it was Alan, Todd, Mark Farner, Christopher Cross.
Denny Lane.
No, Denny Lane was the following year. But that second year, Jack Bruce was the bassist. And then 03 was when I joined up. It was Alan, Todd, Denny Lane, Joey Mollen from Badfinger, and Christopher Cross. So I was in the house band for that one.
Okay.
And that got me, that introduced me. It was the house band for that was myself, Steve Murphy, Godfrey Townsend, and Manny Focarazzo. And we were also the Alan Parsons live project. So we got to back up all those guys in one show. And that was my introduction to Denny and Joey. And my Beatles obsession that I'd been carrying around since I was a kid finally paid off vocationally.
Mm-hmm. Well, we could do a show just on your work with all those musicians. But anyway, our guest here is John Montagna, by the way.
What's up, beautiful people?
And the reason that we're having him on the show is because he's going to be at the Fest for Beatle Fans, and he's doing a special presentation there concerning Paul as a bass player. And in particular, since this is the 50th anniversary of Abbey Road coming up, you're going to be talking primarily about his bass playing on that album, correct?
That's correct. We're going to focus on the bass lines on Abbey Road, which, you know, besides the fact that it's the 50th anniversary of the album, that's usually the record that I tell people when I meet people that tell me, oh, my son just started playing bass, what should he do? And I said, get him a copy of Abbey Road and just learn those bass lines. Yeah. You know, it's some of the best material to study. I mean, Paul's bass playing in general is like boot camp for learning about melody and structure and improvisation and keeping the groove together. But I'll get into that when we start that discussion.
Okay. I do want to talk in general about Paul's bass playing, not just on Abbey Road.
Okay.
But prior to that, the solo music. But here on this show, I just want to make sure that I do a quick apology, because since our last show, which was with Ken Mansfield, we wanted to have that show out in time for the 50th anniversary of the Beatles Apple Rooftop concert. So we've missed the show for the last 3 weeks. And in the course of those 3 weeks, we had the big news about the brand new Let It Be project. And we haven't had a chance to talk about it. And I'm sure that all of us, including John here, wants to express their opinions about the news and what we're hoping it will be, if we have any concerns about it. But for those of you that don't know, there will be a brand new project coming out on the Get Back Let It Be sessions. And Peter Jackson, who's best known for being the director for the Lord of the Rings trilogy, has been given the task of directing it. And he's been given 55 hours of film footage to go through and 140 hours of audio to go through. And in addition to that, I know that a lot of fans will be happy to know that in addition to this project, the original Let It Be film will also be coming out as a separate release. So Peter Jackson has made comments about what he has seen so far, and I guess heard so far. And because of the fact that the film, the Let It Be film, is usually regarded in the context of showing the band's struggles at the time, Peter Jackson has said, and this is a quote from him, that he has a different view. He says, "I was relieved to discover the reality is very different to the myth. After reviewing all the footage and audio that Michael Lindsay Hogg shot 18 months before they broke up, it's simply an amazing historical treasure trove. Sure, there's moments of drama, but none of the discord this project has long been associated with. Watching John, Paul, George, and Ringo work together, creating now classic songs from scratch is not only fascinating, it's funny, uplifting, and surprisingly intimate." And I also wanted to add to that, as one of our own listeners emailed us about this, that Mark Lewisohn tweeted about this, and his comment in response to this was, "The Beatles did it, and now I've done it. An exhausting but exhilarating month's work comes to an end. Finally, I know how it was and how I've been wrong in all my past writings. We've all had it wrong. Roll on Peter Jackson's film and my volume three." Volume two has come out.
Mark is referring to, we should say that Mark's referring to what we mentioned when Ken Mansfield was here, is that like a number of people, he listened to all the Let It Be Nagras on the day, on the 50th anniversary of each day in January, so that he basically had fundamentally the experience of sitting there listening to the sessions, which he had apparently never done before. And it is daunting. I can't blame him. But yeah.
If you could just clarify something for me, Ken. You said how many hours of video and how many hours of audio?
55 hours of film footage, 140 hours of audio.
55 hours does not seem like a lot for, does it?
For a film?
For film, yeah.
Hmm.
Was he given everything that exists and there was only 55 hours worth?
That I don't
know. That's a good point. I mean, over the course of a month, just under a month.
Chop some of the maybe dead time out of there. So maybe it was 3 weeks of, unless they were only playing for a couple of hours every day.
Okay, so let's call it 21 days, 55. That's just about 2 hours a day. And we know that the cameras were running pretty much all day. There's interviews. There's I've seen stuff on YouTube of it looks like the endless takes of Let It Be over and over again, like just the camera that's on John. And he's shifting positions the whole time. He's sitting there with the bass. I mean, and also I think that brings up an interesting point that there's more audio than there is film. So there were moments in the studio where the cameras were not running. And I would imagine that's later on when George came back and said okay, no film, no concert, let's just finish the record. And they got down to work and just went back and started cutting tracks in the studio the way they always did. Cameras probably weren't always running the whole time.
Mm-hmm.
Right. Mm-hmm. Yeah. And that brings up the point for me about this film being such a historical document. I mean, what I would love to see film of them cutting the master take to Don't Let Me Down or something. You know, like the whatever the tracks were that they were cutting in, that they wound up going back into the studio and cutting. Like, is there footage of them playing, you know, doing Don't Let Me Down in the studio, for example? And did they, were the cameras rolling when they caught the master take of that?
Right.
You know?
I think what's a major concern with most people is that if you look at this time as being a depressing time for the Beatles in the studio, and I have no doubt that there was some depressing times and there were joyous times at the same time, you know, is this going to be what some people might view as revisionism? Because if you watch the Let It Be film, you know, I mean, that's
I have,
major
I have something
concern.
To say about it, that.
It's the same thing that we talked about with the White House.
I think
Album.
We all do.
Yeah.
You go first, though.
People are taking the 90 minutes that Michael Lindsay Hogg edited and presented as his version of the Let It Be film as suddenly the actual gospel truth of the universe. It's 90 minutes of the Let It Be sessions, and it's coming out separately anyway. So I don't know. You listen to those Nagra outtakes, and it is not all depressing. I mean, some of it is boring, you know, if you've never been in a band and never sat there from the beginning when someone's calling out the chords and everyone gets it under their fingers, yeah, you might find that a little bit dull, and people may be surprised by that, as if, you know, everyone seems to have believed, I guess, that Beatles songs sprung full-blown from the four of them. But, you know, I'm not really worried about the revisionism thing. I think, you know, the bootlegs and the Nagra tapes have shown us for years and years that there was some great stuff happening and a lot of fun. Mm-hmm. And Peter Jackson's going to show us that side of it. Yeah. If you want to see the depressing one, it's coming out again.
Right. So. I think you're spot on about that, because, okay, let's not forget that you say the word revisionism. This film, by definition, was sort of less than 100% honest as a Beatles product. Let's not forget, this started out as a television documentary about preparing for a live concert. And it's January. I don't know how many of you have ever been to England in the winter, but I spent Christmas in England in 2014, and it was so cold, I thought I was going to die. So being in an empty film studio in January, like right after Christmas, White Album is fresh in the shops, and Paul's like, come on, let's go. Let's do some more stuff. And you know, nobody wanted to be there. Everybody looks pale, and you know, so I've always felt that the whole project to begin with was a little rushed and a little uneven. I mean, Paul, we know, we love him, but he's a workaholic. I mean, I don't know if you, how many of you have got the Red Rose Speedway box set?
We reviewed
okay.
it here.
Inside, did you see inside the book, there's like a to-do list for like when the tour ends. Tour ends August 31st, finish album, do cover, rehearse for tour, back out on the road. I mean, he's unstoppable, right? So it was definitely an uneven project to begin with. And then when they finally had to finish it, because, I mean, I'm telling a story that everybody knows already. Ringo had to go work on the Magic Christian. They had to finish the thing, and then it sat in the can. And that's when Alan Klein got his hands on it and blew it up from 16 mil to 35 to turn it into a feature film so that they could make more money off of it. So by the time it hit the theaters, it was already, the intention behind it had already sort of gotten lost in the shuffle. So who knows whose perspective they were trying to push here. You know, I've never been one of those fans clamoring for a re-release. How come they won't re-release Let It Be? Because it looks terrible. It's edited badly. The audio's out of sync half the time. And, you know, John's talked about wanting to, you know, look, this is us with our trousers off. Can we end the myth now, or whatever the famous quote was? I can see why Paul and Ringo didn't want to revisit it all these years. I think it's great that someone impartial like Peter Jackson is going to rifle through everything like a historical document, like he did with his World War I thing. And my only concerns are, like you say, the revisionism. I hope that they don't gloss over John and Yoko's heroin situation at that time. I think that had a lot to do with his productivity or lack thereof, his enthusiasm for the project or lack thereof, Paul struggling to kind of keep the thing going. I hope that they don't. I mean, it's great that the myth is not what the reality was, and it's great that there was more positivity and than what people are saying. But I just hope that they tell the full story, you know, good and bad, and that it gives the complete picture. But of course, we all know that no matter what comes out, there's going to be people who are dissatisfied.
Sure. And is it possible?
Let's hope for the best.
Is it possible to give you the complete picture in a 2-hour or less film?
Right. That's yeah. true. That's,
the people are going to be saying they've whitewashed it. It's back in sync.
It's not as grainy as I remember it being on my bootleg, you know, VHS dubbed off of the Laserdisc copy that I've been watching my whole life. You know,
it's interesting that we're now finding out that there was more positivity that took place during that month, and that echoes what Giles Martin was saying just months ago when the White Album, the 50th anniversary edition, was out, that he was saying, you know, they've always painted these sessions as being so bleak and the beginning of the end of the Beatles, but there was nothing but joy to my ears in right. going through all of these session tapes. And I think we've here on this show have kind of figured, you know, there's probably a middle ground here from what Giles heard to what was going on when the tapes weren't rolling, that you know, all these years later, all of a sudden we're hearing that the White Album session positive. So now are they going to start
difference...
saying, but the Let It Be sessions, the Get Back sessions, weren't all that bad after all?
Well, the difference is that with the White Album, Giles could only hear what was going on when the tapes were rolling, and on the Let It Be sessions, they were rolling the whole time. You know, so there's going to be more fights on the Let It Be sessions, but there's also, I mean, I don't know, you've listened to the bootlegs. Yeah. There's some hilarious stuff. I mean, I hope they include John's disquisition on Baden Powell.
Yeah. Look, I've been in so many bands in, I don't know how many decades of playing the bass. And there are times within one tour, within 1 week of one tour, where you're like rolling on the floor laughing together, and then the next day you're at each other's throats at a sound check over, you know, whatever it is. None of us will ever know what it was like for those four guys to be in that band at that time, with Apple hemorrhaging money, with all the management and all the business stuff going on around them. And now here they are, like, in this, like, cavernous, like, empty film studio with cameras rolling you know, as was John's description of, like, people filming you in colored lights, and it's cold and it's empty, and they're trying to, like, turn you know, turn straw into gold here, because there's a live show, their first live show in 3 years is, I believe, they already was booked, right? They booked the show, didn't they? They booked the night at the Roundhouse or something, didn't they?
There was they never did settle on exactly what they were going to do.
Okay. Well, I think there was the pressure of going from, like, only having been a studio unit to suddenly they're going to have to do this big concert of all new songs and film the whole process. I mean, again, none of us will ever know what it was like for those guys to be in that band and that kind of pressure and the strain of now Yoko's there. And all that kind of stuff. So I'm sure, yes, there were. It wasn't as bad as it's been made out to be for the last 50 years. But I also don't think there's going to be any way to whitewash George walking out for 2 days,
right?
And that kind of stuff. So hopefully Peter Jackson will tell a balanced story that shows the full spectrum of the experience. But, you know, look, we're all students of the history. There's books that have come out that said that John Lennon was the happiest he'd ever been from 75 to 80 when he was a house husband. And there are books that say that he wanted to jump out a window every day of those 5 years. So who do you believe? Mm-hmm. You know, I've been a stay-at-home dad too, and I can tell you that all of those things happen. You know what I mean? So I think the issue of this revisionist history issue is a touchy one because everyone's perception is different, you know, and we'll see what tale the tapes tell and what the film tells. And hopefully Peter Jackson will, you know, I just think it's really hysterical that they had to get the guy that did Lord of the Rings to go through
I think, you know, with a little bit of CGI, he can have Magic Alex done up as Gollum.
He can. Magic Alex's mixing board will actually work in this one.
I just thought of something. I don't mean to get ahead here because I know we're going to probably briefly talk about now the Egypt Station item that was announced also. But it would be interesting if they did a sort of real mega deluxe set where you can get your own personal hologram of Magic Alex in the Let It Be box set. The Let It Be box set coming out in the spring of 2020. We'll have your own personal Magic Alex.
As Gollum.
That would be great.
Maybe a box set of inventions from Magic Alex that never worked.
I think they're going to do a special, like, super-duper-duper deluxe edition where Paul and Ringo actually step off the UPS truck themselves and deliver it to you with beans on toast.
That's it.
And, you know, and then we'll see how they social media people complain about that. Well. Yeah, well, they were stuck in traffic. They were 15 minutes late. Yeah.
Well, there's a couple of things I just wanted to bring up about this new project, the Let It Be one. And that is that it's really tough when you're a fan all these years, when you've been given a certain narrative for 50 years of this is how Let It Be was. It's so hardened in people's opinion that a lot of people may not believe that there was this other side to the Let It Be sessions. But at the same time, what I always like to say is the camera doesn't lie.
That's
you
right.
Know, what you see in front of you is the way that it was. And there are times when the audio may not be enough because you can listen to a band that sounds like they're having a horrible time going through a song, but they could be smiling through the whole thing and you never know.
That's right.
You know, but the camera's got everything. So I'm happy to see any footage that I've never seen before. And any side of this project, any side of the Let It Be sessions that I've never seen, or what may be the happier side of it all, I welcome. But the only problem is how you tilt it. You know, is it going to be far more positive than negative? And will that be believable? And then should we even question that?
I think you have to assume that Peter Jackson knows the minefield that he's stepping into here. That people... I mean, I'm sure that all of the people surrounding this project and any Beatles project know that we've got this people like us who've got every book ever written that have been studying the history like chapter and verse for 50 years, and we're very emotional about this kind of stuff. And I think he's got to know what he's walking into, and you know, I haven't seen the World War One film that he did on, but I'm really curious too. And I've heard it's like walking into a time machine. What he did with the picture quality and it's also an incredible story. Mm-hmm. But look, I think as Beatles fans, as for people like us, there was a point where all of a sudden we were told that the American albums weren't correct. Oh, you're listening to the American Rubber Soul in stereo? No. It's mono. And it's the English version. Otherwise, it's not what the band intended. And I'm like, so you're gonna tell me that my sense memories that I've had since I was a kid are somehow invalid? I've got to pretend that never existed, you know? So this has been going on. Like every generation, there seems to be a new layer to the story. It's like, oh, now suddenly we have to believe this, you know? And I think it gets touchy when everybody has an opinion online as well. Yeah. I think Peter Jackson's gonna tell a balanced account of the history. I hope so anyway.
Okay. Any final thoughts on this, guys?
Guess not.
No.
Okay.
I think
not,
it's not. The silence was deafening.
Yeah. All right. Let's just move on the other major news item. And there's so many of them, but we have to just narrow it down to this. And the brand new traveling edition of Egypt Station, which is coming out May the 10th. I'm sure just about everybody who listens to this show knows about it. It's got all kinds of goodies involved. I'll just run down real quickly what it has. limited edition black double vinyl, 180 gram. Exclusive limited edition night blue 180 gram vinyl of Egypt Station 2 with unreleased songs. One's called Frank Sinatra's Party. Curious to hear that. 62nd Street. And there's an extended version of Who Cares and four live performances, one from each of the following shows that Paul did, one from Abbey Road, one from the Cavern Club, one from Lipa, and one from Grand Central Station. There's a limited edition concertina CD for Egypt Station, exclusive limited edition Egypt Station on blue cassette, HD audio of all tracks upon shipment, and additional rare performance footage inside. Then, in addition to all that, a few more things. Luxury vintage style embossed Egypt Station artwork suitcase, an exclusive copy of a handwritten note from Paul, fold-out vintage style Egypt Station illustrated map suitable for framing, travel memorabilia, including travel itinerary, postcards, baggage tickets, and a first-class ticket, luggage stickers, a travel journal featuring copies of Paul's handwritten lyrics, two Egypt Station lithographs of Paul's paintings, a 500-piece jigsaw puzzle, and playing cards, plus additional hidden surprises and rarities.
There you go. There you have it. It is going to come with a little bag of pot to recognize the 40th anniversary of Paul's hand. That's
is,
a little is hidden.
The, is there a pot-only edition where you can just buy it?
But then the question is, if this is collectible pot, do you smoke it or do you keep
it? Right.
That's why you got to order Alan two of them, two sets.
Yeah, right.
One bag of pot just keeps sealed and the other to smoke.
Oh, that's hysterical. And how much is this all going for, Ken? I'm on the Paul McCartney website right now, and I'm not seeing a price tag.
It's like 400 bucks with shipping.
Yeah. 300.
It's 360 plus shipping charges, which amounts to over $400.
Yeah.
Well, I mean, I ordered it. I think my reaction, though, to ordering it was a little bit that I didn't get the Wings 71 to 73 box set that had both, and I reacting to not getting that, I jumped on this and then maybe looked a little closer to what was in there after I committed. And while I'm happy I got it, I'm still thinking, yeah, but I bought Pink Floyd box sets that had marbles in them.
Right.
So this isn't quite down to marbles. So for those who don't know, the last time Pink Floyd's catalog got reissued, The Dark Side of the Moon, Wish You Were Here, and The Wall got, super deluxe editions, box sets. And besides all the extra goodies, you did get marbles and I think a scarf, each one.
Yeah.
So you could play marbles, which you would put the Wall scarf on and play with your Wall marbles while listening to all of the demos that were unreleased. So,
but
here we're not getting all the demos that were unreleased. We're getting like three new tracks plus a bunch of live tracks that we already have because they've been out there, all this time. Yeah, I think, I should say, having actually bought this set, so I'm including me in this thing, I suspect that the deck of cards is because if you've bought this set, you're probably spending a lot of time playing solitaire on your own. The puzzle, I don't know what to tell you. Yeah.
I just, when I see things like this, my question is, whose idea was this? I mean,
I think most fans think that it's Paul.
Look, his albums have always been like an adventure. I mean, Venus and Mars, you open up Venus and Mars and there's like a gatefold, there's stuff on the, all of his albums, all the Wings albums came with like a poster and stuff on the inner sleeve. My buddy of mine and I have a theory that Sgt. Pepper was basically the template for the McCartney solo catalog, musically in the sense that like anything and everything could happen. And the whole thing with like the fold-out cover and the inserts and all the bonus, you know, value for your money. You know, I think it was Robert Christgau, who's a writer, was talking about this, and he said, like, you get the impression that if Paul himself is going to come jumping out of the LP cover and yell boo, you know. So he's always there's always been a sense of that with his albums, you know, Press to Play having like the drawings inside of like the stereo picture thing.
I thought that was cool.
I loved that when that came out, because I was just getting into recording in those days and moving stuff in stereo. So, like, you know, seeing that he did that too was really cool. I just don't know that I need, I mean, I'm 47 years old. I don't know that I'm going to, that I need an Egypt Station jigsaw puzzle at this particular time in my life, you know, especially if it's a collectible thing and you feel like if it's a collectible, you want to leave it sealed and all that kind of stuff. You know, I just wonder who they're making this thing for, which is why I don't mind that it's, you know, look, there's 3,000 of them. I'm sure there's 3,000 super fans like yourself that are going to be like, yeah, you know what? This would be cool to have. But it wasn't the kind of thing where I felt like, oh my God, I got to go get that out. Now, when the Red Rose Speedway box was announced, I couldn't wait for that thing. I got it for Christmas and I was thrilled just because I love that record. Been wanting to hear the second album of stuff that wasn't released. And the book, I love all the hardcover books in the archive editions. Yeah. I just don't see this as being an essential item, but I'm also not mad at him for it either. You know, because I think there is a, you know, the way the record industry is going right now, you got to do interesting, unusual stuff to keep people's attention. And this album, I mean, he went all out with the whole carpool karaoke and the pop-up gig in Grand Central Station. I like the fact that he's always thinking outside the box. It's one of the things that I love about him more and more as I get older, is he's always looking ahead and thinking of like, what can I do that hasn't been done before? What's unusual? You know what I mean? So this package is absolutely, you know, it's like I said, inessential, but if someone got it for me as a gift, I'd be very happy, but I'm not going to spend the rent money on it myself.
Yeah. Well said.
Yeah. I can pretty much echo John's words there. As for myself, I've never been one of those people that feels I have to have everything. I care mainly about the music. That's the most important thing. I have to have every song that the Beatles have done, group or solo. If it's an unreleased B-side or a bonus track on a CD single, I got to have all that. I don't care about a jigsaw puzzle. I don't care about playing cards. I don't care about all this. I'm sure it's a very nice package. What would concern me is if the only way that you can get these unreleased songs is on here, because we haven't been told yet. There's a lot of speculation as to whether or not there will be a deluxe version with, I believe Paul said he had 27 songs that he did for this album. So if you put out a double CD with all the songs, I would eat that up. I'd be grabbing it the first day.
Right.
That kind of thing.
And that's what I was expecting this to be when they announced, you know, that there'd be a special thing. I kind of was waiting for all those extra tracks, you know, that were dangled in front of us when the original album came out.
Yeah. Well, he's always had like twice as much stuff in the hopper as what he lets out. He's like Prince. I mean, he's just recording constantly. I mean, think of all the, there's a whole album, Return to Pepperland, right? Wasn't there an entire album in the 80s that didn't get released?
Uh-huh.
Red Rose Speedway, there was like twice as, Red Rose Speedway was supposed to be a double album. Mm-hmm. And then they cut it in half and those tracks got held up and either were B-sides or they'd put out years later. You know, there's all kinds of unreleased stuff in the vaults. I would love to see a collection of all those kinds of things, B-sides and Europe only B-sides. You know, the guy's just got so much stuff that, you know, that he'll sort of like let out in like little drips and drabs here and there as B-sides or as bonus cuts or whatever from that period. And if he's really got like another, you know, album's worth of stuff from last year sitting in the can, I mean, it's up to him whether he wants to put that out or not.
Yeah.
True.
Well, we're always joking about, you know, anniversary editions, maybe the 10th anniversary, it'll all come out. But I just think he's going to sprinkle everything on all these remastered box sets.
Yeah.
And instead of putting out one great big colossal unreleased songs package, which I think is what we'd all love to have all at once, but yeah, you're going to have to buy everything through all the remastered albums.
Right. But I think the other thing here that is, I remember reading an article years ago. They interviewed Neil Aspinall in some trade publication. I forget which one it was. And one of the key things he was talking about the success of Apple, I think it was around the time of the anthology. And they were trying to figure out why this band that hasn't been a functioning unit for 20 odd years is the top selling entity in the industry. Mm-hmm. And one of the keys to their success was that they didn't saturate the market, that they spaced out the releases, you know, with enough room in between them so that people didn't get tired of it. You know, they would let just a little bit of stuff out, and they would wait long enough to create the demand.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I mean? So I think he's conscious of that as well. I mean, he's the master of that as far as I'm concerned.
Right. Okay.
Yeah.
One last thing before we get to our main topic. Let us not forget, as we're doing this show on February 18th, send out happy birthday wishes to Yoko, who's 86 today. God bless her.
Oh, my God. Right.
Yes. Yep. Happy birthday, Yoko. Happy and birthday, they Yoko. Announced the reissue of the wedding album today.
Yeah.
That's right.
Nice.
You know, happy birthday, Yoko.
Doesn't come with a jigsaw album. Puzzle.
Is it now? Is it the original wedding album with like the photos and the slice of wedding cake and all
it's
that kind of stuff?
Be. That's what I read.
I think so. Yeah, I think the vinyl will have that, and it will be white vinyl.
I'm sorry, Alan. The CD is going to be, I think, just a basic, you know, the audio and maybe I guess a booklet, but this vinyl I think is going to be a replica of the package from '69.
Mm-hmm.
Then when they put out the two versions deluxe box set, it'll have a jigsaw puzzle of the album.
Oh God.
Sorry. But anyway, happy birthday, Yoko.
Yes. Yeah. Okay, so let's get to our main topic here, which is about Paul as a bass player, and in particular about the Abbey Road album. But I would like to just talk about the very beginning in these years of the Beatles. What made Paul, what was his bass playing like early on? In the sense of, what did he do differently as a bass player compared to other bass players of that time?
Okay. Well, you have to remember, to the best of our knowledge, Paul started playing the bass in 1961. Is that when Stu Sutcliffe quit the band? Well, and so 61. Okay. Yeah. What makes Paul such an interesting bass player, one of the things that you got to remember, that first of all, the bass guitar had only been in existence for about 10 years at that point. Leo Fender was the first manufacturer to successfully develop and mass produce an electric bass guitar to take the EADG. Let me turn up my volume here. The EADG of the double bass and put that onto a guitar body. Other companies had tried to electrify a double bass. Leo Fender was the first one to successfully manufacture a bass guitar, the Fender Precision Bass. That was in 1951. So to begin with, the instrument has only been around for about a decade. Rock and roll, a lot of rock and roll was still double bass. All those early Sun records with Elvis Presley, Bill Black's playing a double bass.
Mm-hmm.
So there was no vocabulary on the bass guitar yet in rock and roll. It wasn't like now where you want to play rock bass. There's like dozens of books on how to play rock bass and YouTube videos on how to, you know, learn the bass line from here. So there was none of that. So Paul was learning. There was no formal pedagogy. Is that the word I'm looking for? There was no vocabulary on the bass guitar for rock and roll. The other thing that makes Paul interesting is Paul's bass playing interesting is that he became the bass player for the Beatles. It wasn't like he got a bass and was learning how to play it and then joined this band. He was learning the bass for the gig that he was already in, mm-hmm. right? For a band that he was already in. So he had a very utilitarian approach to it. He started playing bass out of necessity, right, and not for any other reason, for the band that he was already in. So whatever he was going to learn how to do was going to be within the context of that band and their repertoire and their vibe and the pocket that they were trying to lay down. Paul belongs to what I refer to, my personal Mount Rushmore of rock bass is McCartney, John Entwistle, Jack Bruce, and John Paul Jones. Those four guys to me are the guys who basically invented the vocabulary of rock bass guitar that is still being used today. All four of those guys came to the bass guitar not as their first instrument. Entwistle was a brass player. Jack Bruce was a cellist. John Paul Jones was a keyboard player. They all came to the bass guitar after having played other instruments. They also learned how to play the instrument primarily within the groups that they were in. So they were gigging right away. Jack was already working as a double bassist in England. Got a bass guitar and was doing sessions on it immediately. There was no template, no influences. There was no, who do you like as a bass player? There was really nobody to copy. There were no licks to steal. So Paul was kind of just making it up as he went along. They're in Hamburg. Somebody had to play the bass, and Paul went for it and got the Hofner because A, it was symmetrical. As much as we know, because no one has sat down with Paul for an in-depth bass-centric interview yet, although I'd like to one day, but that's a whole other conversation. As far as we know, I mean, we've heard stories that he bought the Hofner because it was cheap, but I've also heard that instrument was that he actually had to do like a layaway plan because it was kind of pricey, but also because it was symmetrical and he could turn it over left-handed. So, but you know, Paul playing the bass in a sort of group that was already set up. You know, it was very utilitarian in the beginning. You've heard the recordings. Mm-hmm. You know, so it was only later. I mean, again, if all Paul ever did was write those songs, if all he ever was a songwriter, his place in the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame would be complete. This is one of the greatest melodic writers of his time, right? So it's inevitable that this guy's creativity, his natural creativity and his natural flair for melodicism is going to come out. So in the beginning, he's basically holding it together. He's, you know, laying down the root of the chords. Last night I said these words to my girl. You know, pretty solid, just solid holding it together. And he's instinctively musical. Like the guy's made out of music. So he knows that there are certain things you can hear in the early recordings where you can tell that he's taking advantage of like the sustain, the attack and the decay and the sustain and the release. Like Anna is one that comes to mind. You know, the first note is long and the second one is short. Anna. You know, you've got a lot of power as a bass player to dictate not just the harmonic structure of the music, because a chord's not a chord till it has a bass note.
Were other bass players doing that though?
That is a good question. I think the bass, you know, McCartney has said the bass player was the fat guy in the back. Nobody wanted to do that gig.
Yeah.
Right. I don't know about in rock and roll how conscious it was. You'd have to talk to somebody like Bill Wyman. Or whoever.
What about the Motown guys? What about the Motown guys?
I think he revered those. Yeah, well, the Motown guys were jazz musicians. Mm. Those guys in Detroit, James Jamerson and Benny Benjamin and Earl Van Dyke, those guys were Detroit jazz musicians. And word got out that there was this guy that's starting a record label and he's looking for a house band to cut these sessions. Those records were cut in an afternoon because jazz is all about improvisation, right? You've got a structure, a set of chord changes, and that's it. And within an hour, these guys could look at like, you know, C, F, D minor, G, and make music out of it just by listening to each other and vibing off of each other and trying to come up with a groove that works. I don't know what was going on in Paul's head at that time, but listening to the recordings then, you know, the early stuff, he's holding it together, but occasionally there's a few little licks that come out. Like one of my favorites, make sure I'm not distorting here. One of my favorites is on Roll Over Beethoven, right? He's like, got a little bit, gonna mail it to my local DJ. It's your basic root 3 3-5 that all the bass players were doing. And in the bridge, he does this lick that I just absolutely love. And if you're feeling like it, get your lover and reel and rock it. That little thing. You know, you can start to hear him have a little fun with this thing. But he's very concerned with doing the job and keeping it solid, locking in with Pete Best and then later on with Ringo. I don't know that he's consciously thinking like, what else can I do here until later? And that's when the Motown influence happened. That's when the Brian Wilson influence happened. But, you know, early on, I think he was just doing his job of gluing it together and keeping the groove happening, because they were still playing dance halls and stuff. So it was all about the groove and the beat and keeping people on the dance floor there. You know what I mean?
What about for me, one of his sort of breakout early tracks as an inventive bassist is All My Lovin', where it's really almost a line of counterpoint. You know, it's not your standard, you know, do-do-do-do-do-do-do. It's a totally different.
Well, again, you're dealing with a different kind of songwriting talent as well.
Mm-hmm.
You know, close your eyes and I can do. I mean, it's. I mean, those are pretty heavy chord changes to dance around.
Yeah. I'm glad you played that. I love that bass line.
Oh, yeah, me too. Yeah. Well, I used to sub with a tribute band here in New York called Strawberry Fields, and that was the opening song. So I'd have the wig, the boots, the suit, the whole bit. And as long as I could go, close your eyes, and I'll keep... Once I did that, then I was okay. I could start the show, you know. And it's the other thing that doing that gig has really made me appreciate Paul as a bass player and as an entertainer as well. I don't know if any of you have ever tried to play in a Beatles tribute band that does the full costume bit. It is physically demanding. It is like a physical effort to stand up straight and play those bass lines and sing in that register with a big smile on your face the whole time.
Right.
It's in the boots. I mean, it's. How he still does that now at 76 or whatever is, you know, it's a lot harder than it looks. Mm-hmm. So, but the other thing that I noticed, you know, putting this presentation together for the fest, going down the list of the songs, you know, he seems to do, you know, talking about him as a bassist versus being a songwriter, and how a lot of the he's using the same skill set writing melodies as he is writing bass lines. I mean, it's starting to infect the bass lines. He seems to do his best. I mean, it's a relative, you know, it's a matter of opinion. But some of his most interesting bass lines tend to be on John's songs and George's songs when he's not the songwriter.
Mm-hmm.
When he's just the bass player.
He's admitted this.
Oh, has he?
Yeah, because all he had to do was concentrate on the bass part then.
Right, right. And I would imagine, you know, him being founding members of the band and, you know, he's going to get his own rocks off in there somewhere. You know what I mean? Hmm. But if you think of Everybody's Got Something to Hide Except for Me and My Monkey, Day in the Life, Dear Prudence.
Lucy in the Sky with Diamonds.
Lucy in the Sky with Diamonds, Taxman, Old Brown Shoe.
Old Brown Shoe was George.
Really?
Yeah.
I better take that off my list for the
it's funny. You react like that because I actually only maybe the last couple of years realized that was George playing.
Really?
On Old Brown Shoe. And I always thought, wow, that was great. That's a great bass line.
So it was George. Piano on that? Is Paul playing piano on that?
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah, George admitted this in Cream magazine, I think it was, around the time of Cloud Nine. And up until then, I never knew that was okay. George.
That's a rather lively bass line.
Oh, yeah.
Didn't George once, at some point, pass a comment about Paul being sometimes a little too busy of a bass player, or John did?
Well, on Something, on the song Something, I think George said to Paul that, your bass line's too busy. And it's such a great bass line.
That's one of the key bass lines of all time, as far as I'm concerned. that's a line that you could play as a melody. You could give that bass line to an alto sax, and it would and it would be an engaging melody. I mean, there's a lot of space in that song, and if I were McCartney, I'd want to fill it with with something, as it were. But you know, it's, I mean, look, you know, I mean, it's, he's doing everything that a bass line is supposed to do. He's outlining the changes, but of course, they don't want to leave it now. I mean, he's doing the job. I mean, he's outlining the changes. He's keeping the groove together. I mean, that, I mean, he and Ringo together are like really like stretching the taffy on that thing. but, the thing I love is on the bridge when it's a, I mean, again, you've got all this control as a bass player to shift the melody around as well, with how, you know, how long you hold the note. If it's a, if you, you know, these eighth notes are going to do something different than these, you know what I mean? And he just seems to have an instinctive grasp of this. I don't know that he had any sort of formal training, anyone telling him like, oh, you know what, on this section, make it more staccato. I think it was, it just seems like it was purely instinctual on his part.
I think so too.
But again, he was blessed with the rhythm section partners of not just Ringo on drums, but John Lennon, one of the most underrated rhythm guitarists. I mean, a track like Can't Buy Me Love, Lennon's acoustic guitar on that track, I mean, that's the drums on that track is John. You know, his rhythm guitar mixed with the bass and the drums, made it was just such an amazing rhythm section. And that's, you know, you can play a busy bass line all you want, but if your partners in the rhythm section aren't there to catch you, the bottom's going to fall out. You know what I mean? And so you need that kind of trust. You know, you got to know that Ringo's going to hit that 2 and 4 exactly where it needs to be. There's a moment during the guitar solo on Something. Right? Ringo does these like, he does like these rolls on the toms that anyone else, it would have just fallen apart. But like the rest of the band is like, the rest of the band has got his back. They're supporting him. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? So when you examine Paul's bass playing, you can't help but examine the context that his bass playing was happening in, which was that band, which was, you know, surrounded by Ringo and John and George as a full rhythm section. So it's not just enough to play a busy bass line. You've got to make it fit. And that was his genius too. And still is doing something that's cool and melodic and all that, but maintaining an effective partnership with the rest of the band, you know, reining it in so that there's still a foundation there.
Mm-hmm. John, I have a question about going back to the early days.
Okay.
About Paul was one of the guitarists in the Beatles when in the earliest days when Stu Sutcliffe was in the band. When he switched to bass, how did his guitar playing feed what he did on the bass? And is that what we're hearing in a song like I Saw Her Standing There, which was the earliest bass part that really caught my eye of all of the early songs?
That's a good question. I mean, I think pretty much from the beginning, he was playing with a pick.
And that was not, I mean, being that the stand-up was still still a fixture in music, you're not playing that instrument with a pick.
Right.
That was another, I guess, a holdover from him being a guitarist first.
My educated guess is, yeah. You know, I mean, someone would have to speak to him about that. But if you look at, I mean, I'm trying to think of like an early rock and roll tune that's got a double bass on it, maybe like on Don't Be Cruel. you know, that you would do fingerstyle. I'm pretty sure he went with a pick from the beginning, and I think it must have informed his technique and his approach, because again, there was no rock bass guitar methodology in existence yet. Mm-hmm. The jazz community was really slow to embrace the bass guitar. I went to Berkeley in the 90s, and there were jazzers who thought, like, well, if you're not playing upright, it's not a real instrument.
Right.
Still, yeah. So although one of the first prototype precision basses Leo Fender manufactured, he brought to the Lionel Hampton band. And Lionel Hampton's big band was on the road, 10 months a year or whatever it was. So he brings it to Lionel Hampton, and Lionel Hampton is like, this is great. Now we don't have to cart the giant bull fiddle around. That's going to cut our cartage bill by whatever, 10% or whatever. So he gives it to his bassist, who was like, I ain't playing that. That's not a real bass. And they were like, no, this is the bass now. And after like two nights, I forget the bass player's name. Oh, geez. Anyway, he was like, you know what? This is great. I can play sitting down. I can hear myself more. It's, the notes are ringing out. So it was, I would have to trace the evolution of the bass guitar in rock and roll a little bit more to see who else was doing it. I mean, Bill Wyman and the Stones, but there were just as many, rock and roll bands that were still playing upright. So I would have to think that the guitar, him coming from the guitar would have had to have influenced him. I mean, all the films we see of him in those days, he's playing with a pick. There's definitely a guitar type of approach.
And there are also some things that he probably stole from his own guitar playing days. Like Darren mentioned, I saw her standing there. I think the bass line to that is identical to Chuck Berry's Talking About You, yeah, which was right. in their repertory.
And I think Paul actually admitted to that.
Yep. Yeah.
But I mean, there's, when I remember when I started playing bass, when I noticed how many songs are like root five, root three, five. There's a handful of patterns that get used like over and over again, So that doesn't surprise me. But again, him being one of the songwriters, one of the primary songwriters, once he and John started writing all the time, and now he's thinking in terms of outlining the harmonic structure of the song, and not just playing like rock and roll patterns. I think it was a combination of a lot of things coming together at once. And again, the fact that he was in the band right away, it wasn't like he got the bass and like spent a few months in the woodshed getting good until he was ready to go out and play a gig. It's like, go to the store, buy the bass, bring it to the gig that night, and bam, you're on the job. So it was on the job training for him as well. Talking about the Abbey Road album, when he did the Abbey Road album, when he did the bass line on Something, when he did the bass line on I Want You, She's So Heavy, he'd been playing the bass for 8 years. You know what I mean? That just blew my mind when I figured that out, that here's a guy that's been playing the instrument for 8 years, and he's doing some of the most inventive stuff that bass players today are still trying to figure out.
Those bass licks on that song, I Want You, She's So Heavy, really make the song.
Yeah. Well, again, a John song. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. And just, he's reinforcing John's rhythm guitar. I mean, I found some isolated tracks from Abbey Road online, which, as you know, those are very difficult to find. It takes several seconds of Googling isolated Abbey Road tracks, and bam, there they are, right? But like, he goes, I want you. He's playing double stops. He's playing like power chords on the bass in that section. So I don't know who came up with that break in the middle, like, and then a space. I don't know who said, like, hey, Paul, do a bass lick there. Whose idea that was conceptually. But, like you say, it's perfect. It gives me chills every time. And I'm really looking forward to playing it at the fest.
John, yeah. The Hofner bass as an instrument, at the time that Paul picked it up, its evolution. Was it a quality instrument? Was it a cheap instrument?
Well, the story is that he got the Hofner because it was the cheapest one that he could find. Unlike John and George, who spent all kinds of money buying fancy American Rickenbackers and Gretsches and stuff. Paul was always, you know, very, very cautious with a dollar and bought this cheap German instrument because they were in Germany. I've played real Hofners and I'll go on record as saying I'm not a tremendous Hofner fan, apart from playing Beatles stuff. You know, they're not, and this is true for a lot of bass guitars in those days, apart from Fender. Again, it was a new instrument, and a lot of guitar manufacturers thought, well, we better make a bass. You know, we better have a bass guitar in our product line. And so they would just basically take their whatever guitar they had and, you know, put bass strings on it. And I think that was the Hofner deal as well. They're tricky to keep in tune. It's a hollow body. They're fun to play. They're light. You know, this one, the one I'm playing now, this is actually a Carlo Robelli, which is a company I think that Sam Ash might have had something to do with. I think it was like their in-house. Well, they were sold at Sam Ash anyway. Carlo Robelli. They make sort of cheap knockoffs of different instruments. This was $200 off the rack at Sam Ash in Brooklyn on Flatbush Avenue, and it's black. I'm describing because you can't see it. It's black with a mother of pearl pickguard, violin shaped, and it's a violin bass. I've got flat wounds on it, so it does the trick in terms of demonstrating the Hofner stuff. The Hofners, I mean, there's people that love them, and there's collectors that know all the ins and outs about those instruments. I'm not a tremendous fan of them myself, but I think the fact that the instrument was hollow accounts for a lot of the sustain. I can tell you that when you're in a band playing with a band on stage with that instrument going through an amp, it resonates really easily. I just heard the isolated track for Get Back, by the way. The isolated bass track for Get Back is horrendously out of tune. You wouldn't think it, but it was like, I mean, it's ridiculous, you know, but you don't notice it for some reason. It just sounds funky. But the Hofner, I mean, again, you'd have to ask Paul what he thinks of that. Having played a lot of different basses, including a hollow body violin bass, there is definitely, you know, I mean, playing the Beatles music with a violin bass definitely makes the difference just in terms of the sustain and the resonance of the thing. You know, something like Please Please Me, you know, you need something that's going to sustain like that and be kind of woofy and thick that way.
When Paul moved off the Hofner, it was like in the late 60s, maybe the White Album, possibly Abbey Road, somewhere in there.
They gave
instrument he went to?
Yeah, the Rickenbacker company gave him a bass. They gave him I believe it was a 4001 that I think he initially turned down. I think when Hard Day's Night came out and George was playing the Rickenbacker 12 string, I think the Rickenbacker company was, you know, met them in California, and they had a guitar for George and a bass for Paul, and Paul originally turned it down and then took it, I think, like a year or two later. Again, what impact that had on him, you'd have to ask him or draw your own conclusions by listening. There are a lot of tracks that there's some debate as to which bass he used. People always ask me, is he using the Rickenbacker or the Hofner on Abbey Road? Some people that are more knowledgeable about this stuff than I am have told me that by the time he got the Rickenbacker, I mean, he was like pretty much everything in the studio, White Album, Abbey Road, after a certain point was Rickenbacker in the studio exclusively. But he's using the Hofner in the Let It Be sessions, certainly on the rooftop and on the, you know, in the film studio. And in the when they were in the basement at Savile Row. But I can tell you from my own experience, Rickenbackers, unlike Hofner's, which are light, made out of balsa wood, Rickenbackers are big and heavy. They weigh a ton. I did a Wings tribute many, many years ago, and I had to go to like a vocal coach and like take like one extra yoga class every week just to hold up a Rickenbacker and sing Jet in the original key. It was like, it's tough. So, but the Rickenbacker bass is, you know, it's heavy. It's a solid body. But again, you're talking about instrument that's got flat wound strings on it, going through an amp, which is then mic'd. Then the mic is going into a tube console, you know. So the talking about McCartney's bass sound, the instrument is only part of it. You know, I've had some success playing Abbey Road and White Album tracks on the Rebelli, on the violin bass too, and it seems to work. So how the instrument affected him, and again in the 70s, in the late 70s, back to the Egg era, Yamaha gave him a bass. But he still sounds like Paul McCartney. You know what I mean? No matter what instrument you give that guy, there's photos of him from the Band on the Run sessions where he's playing a Fender jazz bass. But he always sounds like Paul McCartney, no matter which instrument you give him. So I don't get too involved in the gear stuff. There are people like who's the guy that wrote the Beatles gear book? Andy Babu. Yeah. There's guys who have researched that to a T. I'm more concerned with his approach as a musician and what he did in terms of it. You know, I mean, I say it all the time. He's one of the guys that basically invented the vocabulary of the bass guitar in rock and roll. And I feel like he's got, again, you'd have to ask him this, but it sounds to me like he has like a macro view of the music. Like he looks at the entire picture the way an orchestrator would, and he structures his bass lines in such a way that, yeah, they're cool and funky, there's a lot of notes and they're busy and they're exciting, but they also have to fit within the picture of the music. They stand out enough to grab your attention, but it also has to support the song. You know, when you listen to something, your ears go to George's voice. You know, you can go and solo the bass track and it's exciting, but whatever's going on, whatever he's doing, has to be in support of the music and the song. And to be a team player like that, that's the thing that really impresses me as a bassist. And that's a very tricky line to walk when you want to do something that's impressive and you want to show off, but you have a responsibility to your bandmates and to your fellow songwriters, you know? So
that's what the Beatles were all about, complimenting each other.
That's right. That's right. And being a team and sort of being in service to the music. I think, you know, when I tell people, when I tell young guys, you know, to study the Beatles music, I feel like Paul's bass playing is the best stuff to study in terms of understanding, you know, form and function, stuff that's cool to play and fun to play and impressive and tricky enough that you kind of got to develop your chops just a little bit more to get it under your fingers, but also being in service to the music and being creative and doing something different and holding down the groove. You know what I mean? Doing all of those things together, that's what makes you a complete musician. And I, you know, I'm biased because that was my foundation. I feel like it's, you know, studying his, you know, he was the guy when I started playing bass, he was the guy. And then it was Entwistle after that. But I feel like it's given me an advantage as a player. You know, when someone throws a song at me, I don't get freaked out when I hear a bunch of chord changes. Whoa, 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 what's that? You know, I know to think of the entire picture of the music and come up with something that's going to fit, you know, and be supportive and inventive. And he's absolutely the master of that. And I recommend him as the guy to study, but I'm not a fundamentalist about it. If Geddy Lee is your guy, if Flea is your guy, great, go for it. But, you know, I just feel like studying him as a bassist I just feel like you're going to have an advantage. Like the McCartney guys that I know, you know, we all, it's like a little secret society, you know, we all, there's like, I feel like there's a little bit of, you have a little bit of an advantage in terms of playing for the song, you know, and there's a handful of guys that I would consider to be like direct disciples of him. I'm thinking of Bruce Thomas from Elvis Costello and the Attractions, Chris Squire, certainly Graham Mabey from Joe Jackson's band, Mike Massaros from the Smithereens, another hugely underrated melodic player, and Colin Moulding from XTC. These are guys that are all, you know, very melodic, but incredibly solid, and always working in support of the song that they're doing. Like they're the songwriter's best friend, you know.
I want to ask a couple of questions about Paul's bass playing and whether or not it really was innovative for its time and what it brought to the music. And one of which you were talking about before, the power chords. Yeah. I know that there are times when Paul will do something, and I forget which songs they are, but he'll play two notes at the same time, and yeah, they're an octave apart. Was that something that was that unique for its time, and what did that bring to the song?
Was it unique to its time? I mean, I would say maybe in pop music, certainly, although maybe not so much, because again, you're talking about an instrument that was still fairly young, and there wasn't a very specific, there was no methodology, there were no rules yet, right? So you had guys, all of the bass players like Joe Osborne, rest in peace, Carole Kaye. I'm talking about Americans now. These were people who switched to bass from the guitar and were making it up as they went along. So whether or not it was fairly unique, possibly in the top 10, but you know, I'm sure there must have been somebody playing octaves on a bass guitar somewhere. But I know in I Want to Hold Your Hand, which you know, Alan, I know you wrote literally wrote the book on that song. During the bridge, right, he's hitting the double stops there, I believe, right? And when I touch you, I feel happy. And I think there's some in And I Love Her, maybe. Oh, and no. What's not And I Love Her? All I've Got to Do. Whenever I mean, that's a total guitar technique thing. People certainly weren't doing that on the double bass. What did it bring to the music? I think it was just a continuation of, you know, these guys just were eternally curious, and creatively they would try anything. You know, I think that what sets them apart from every other band is that they never just kind of like went into the studio and like just hacked through it and, you know, phoned it in. They were always searching for like, what else can I do that's different? What that I haven't done yet, that other people haven't done yet, you know, how can I make this different? Even if it means we all switch instruments, you know? So, I mean, what did, you know, what did that bring to the music? I mean, it brought that sound to the rhythm section on that song, and it sounds cool and it's fine, but I think it was just part of their boundless creativity and curiosity and restlessness. Like what else can we do here? You know, one of the George tracks I forgot to mention is Think for Yourself. Hey, let's put a fuzz bass on here. You know, let's try this. Let's try that. They were one of the first rock bands to really get into the studio and you know this, and experiment with, you know, what else can we do here? How can we make this exciting? So does that answer your question, Ken?
I feel think
like
so.
I'm rambling a lot.
I almost kind of feel like you've answered my second question, which would have been, if you want to answer this. I know Paul likes to bring up occasionally that he likes when the melody of a song goes up, that the bass line goes down.
Sure.
Like on Michelle or something like that. Is that something that was unique? Or as you were saying, you know, we don't really know.
Again, yeah. I think it was unique to pop music. I think you can find, you know, there's like hundreds of years of classical and symphonic music where all of this, you know, could be studied, you know, counterpoint. I'm sure there's, you know, J.S. Bach was writing counterpoint in the 1600s or 1700s. I should really know what century Bach was alive in, but in any case,
Alan? 1685 to 1750.
Thank you.
He doesn't have to Google that. So.
Okay, good. Thank you. I appreciate that. But you know what I mean? I think it was unique for pop music. I think it was unique in to have a band in the top 10 selling millions of records to screaming girls to be doing that kind of stuff. And I think, again, one of the things that sets the Beatles apart from all those other bands is when people like Leonard Bernstein were coming out and saying, no, this is some different stuff here. You got to check out what these guys are doing. You know, the famous quote is, there was some music critic writing about the Aeolian cadences
right.
in Not a Second Time, which is basically a fancy way of saying like ending on the sixth chord, right? No, not a second time. Instead of no, which would be ending on the root. The phrase ends on the sixth chord, which is in the key of G, is E minor, right? Mm-hmm. That's an Aeolian cadence, right? Again, I'm sure that they weren't thinking like, hey man, let's end on the sixth chord. I think they were just they were writing the song and it ended on the phrase. Ended on E minor, and they say, yeah, that sounds good. Let's keep that. Totally instinctual with those guys. You know, again, this is the thing that blows me away, that here we are. We're all like in our, you know, I'm in my late 40s. I play with guys who are 50, 60 years old, still deciphering what these guys were doing all before they turned 30. You know what I mean? And I love watching this music trip up like really talented musicians, guys who are really, really good. And they always seem to come to me. I have a dear friend in Tucson, a bass player named Dwayne Hollis, who's in a band called Greyhound Soul, monster musician and a lovely guy as well. And we went out there for Christmas this year, and he was doing some of the musicians in Tucson were doing a Let It Be rooftop tribute concert in January. You know, all the guys from the scene are all, you know, taking turns playing these songs. So I get to their house and Dwayne's like, dude, I need your help. I'm doing this gig. I have to play Paperback Writer. What do I do, man? I had no idea. Like Dwayne, you want to play Paperback Writer? He says, yeah, okay. And he listens to it and he had no idea that the bass line was so intricate. And he was like panicking, like, dude, what do I, how do I do this? I need your help, you know? And people forget that there was a lot of intricate stuff going on. I was in a thing recently, well, not too recently, but it was a couple of years ago. I was in a thing where we were playing I Want You, She's So Heavy. And the drummer couldn't fathom the idea of she's so coming in with a completely different tempo, different feel, different everything. And the guy's like, who's going to count that in? And I'm like, no one. We're just going to go, she's so. And he's like, what? But we're playing a completely different groove and a completely different tempo right before that, you know, and it trips people up. So I think within, you know, for a pop group, quote unquote, this stuff was unusual. Yeah. And I think he helped to, you know, much like the Beatles expanded the vocabulary of rock and roll music, where suddenly there's some different harmonies coming in, some different rhythms, you know, George bringing the Indian influence in, you know, the vocabulary of popular music expanded. So did the vocabulary for the bass guitar, just grew by leaps and bounds, thanks to McCartney and all the other guys as well. But he really, I think, was the first to expand the rock bass line beyond just, you know, root five, root 3/5, you know, to play melodies, to play counter melodies, take advantage of like not playing the root of the chord, you know, which he got from Brian Wilson, he gives credit to. So, you know, again, the counter melodies always would still support the groove and the harmonic structure of the song. Like he never did anything that was too distracting where the thing would fall apart. That's where the genius is to do something that's interesting and inventive, but is still supportive and utilitarian Does that make sense?
Sure. Yeah.
That's what I'm going to try to get across. I really want to get that across at the fest. You know, I want musicians to understand that this is, as much as we're all into the history and all that kind of stuff, as musicians, I think it's important for us to all understand that these guys, above all, were always in service to the music. It wasn't about their egos as players. You know, maybe, okay, they throw it to George to grab a solo or whatever. But all of the parts that these guys came up with were in service to the music, to make the song more interesting and compelling, and to keep to support what the songwriter was trying to achieve, you know. And I think that's an important thing for us to promote as musicians and for us to study. So I hope that answers your question without too much rambling.
Mm-hmm.
Alan, I mean, I'm very passionate about this stuff, as you can see.
Yeah. Alan, you have a question?
The only question I had is about Paul's playing more generally over his whole career. I mean, in the Beatles, that to me seems to be, you know, such an incredible contrapuntal playing and so inventive. And in his solo years, I think he stepped back a bit. And when people have asked him about that, he said, well, you know, the style's changed. But you don't tend to hear in that many of his tunes the kind of bass playing that he brought to the Beatles. I mean, there are some, you know, Silly Love Songs is a pretty active bass line. But mostly he seems to have sort of scaled it back. Why do you think that was?
Again, you'd have to ask him that. But my educated guess is that he had other priorities at that time, because, you know, when he was in the Beatles, he was just a single component within, you know, there's John, George, and Ringo. I mean, it was four superstars all in one band, all serving this Beatles idea, right? Okay, now in Wings and on his own, he's the guy. So he's not just the bass player in the band. He's also the songwriter. He's the producer. He's the band leader. He's got to worry about payroll, the tour manager, all that kind of stuff. So that being said, I think there are enough examples. You can go through the solo catalog and find examples of him where he's getting his licks in, for sure. You know, one of my favorites that nobody ever talks about is Loop, First Indian on the Moon.
Oh.
There's a break.
Okay.
Yeah. And he does this, like, he ends on like the major seven, like the third of the five chord, because it's the two chords are A minor and E, and it's like A minor, E minor, and then it's E major, right? And for him to end on that is just so sassy, right? And then the second time it comes around. You know, there are a few examples here and there. Good Night Tonight is another one.
Yeah.
You know,
Another Day has a great bass line.
Yeah. There's certainly examples of that. But you're right. It's not quite like it was in the Beatles. But again, I think he had other priorities. And I also think, if you think about how Wings came together, he's talked about how he wanted to start from scratch. He didn't want to, you know, he's, you know, how do you top the Beatles, right? Rather than just put together a super group around himself as Paul McCartney, he got a bunch of guys together and they got into the van and started playing universities. I mean, it was very punk rock to just like, we're not going to book gigs. We're not going to do anything. We're just going to pile into a van and start driving and find a place to play. I mean, that's badass. So I think Wings was primarily a live unit, unlike the Beatles, which had pretty much become a studio unit by that time. I mean, they did the rooftop concert, but after that, they weren't playing live. When you're on stage in front of a bunch of university students trying to rock people's asses in the moment, you're going to play differently than if you're in the studio creating a bass line. A lot of the songs that he was writing in the early days didn't call for much beyond just, like, you know, pumping out eighth notes or whatever it was, like the Mess. Oh, sweet darling, You know, when your job as a bass player, when you're in a band where your job is to be on stage, you know, just rocking out for an hour, you're going to play differently and think differently than if you're in the studio crafting out, you know, a contrapuntal line to a George Harrison track, you know. So I think a lot of that had to do with the function of Wings at that time. They would, you know, they were touring a lot. You know, he'd wanted the Beatles to tour again. I mean, this is a guy who like craves being on stage, you know, as is evidence of the fact that he's still out there now. I mean, all of us, I'm sure, have seen him live within the last decade or so. I saw
many times.
I saw both nights at Barclays Center 2017. I'm like looking at a 70 something year old man going, how does he play for 3 hours? How does he do that? You know, this is a guy who like lives and breathes music on stage. You're dealing with a very unique, once in a lifetime kind of talent here. But I think when you're on stage playing stadiums, playing songs like Soily and, you know, Junior's Farm, those kinds of songs require a different approach.
Jet.
You know what I mean? Sure. So I don't know that the creativity tapered off, because again, you can go through, scan the catalog and find examples of some really cool little licks that he's doing. But I think it was just, you know, by the time he got to the solo career, his priorities were different, and his motivation, he had something else to prove. And he was motivated by different things beyond just being part of a band.
Like sometimes you can listen to Paul's solo music and you'll hear something that you didn't hear before, like all music, really.
Right.
And I'm in the car a few months ago and I listened to the Driving Rain CD. And I heard a lot of bass playing in there that I hadn't heard. Maybe it was because it was in the car, the speakers, however the music came to me. And I noticed a lot on Egypt Station. There's a lot of bass work on Egypt Station.
Right.
Listen to I Don't Know. Interesting little licks that he puts on that song.
Definitely.
So it's kind of sneaky. You may not notice it as much, but it's there.
Yeah. Yeah. We're doing a parent music festival here at my daughter's school in a couple of weeks. And I'm getting together with a friend of mine, one of the other dads, and we're going to do Veronica. And I'm really looking forward to that. These are all the names. Doing his bass line on Veronica, you know, his use of the pentatonic scale, the pentatonic scale being the AKA the blues scale, 1-3-5, 1-3-4-5 flat 7 root, you know, all those little things,
yeah.
You know, that's, you know, I mean, his approach is just sort of like in my DNA, you know, and I'm still kind of learning how to like verbalize it and explain it. So I apologize if my answers have been like kind of a little tangential.
I'll tell you one song that jumps out at me is See Your Sunshine from Man I Must Fool. There's a lot, his bass playing's all over the place on that song.
Wasn't there a story about that, like where the producer said, like, just try one where you're just playing whatever the hell you want. Just go off and do it. And that was the one that they kept.
Right. that's what I heard.
Yeah.
So as far as Abbey Road is concerned, do you think that in the Beatle years, that was the best bass playing from Paul?
Well, I mean, that's all a matter of opinion. I think that the Abbey Road lines, they must have known that this was going to be the final album, right? I don't know that they were consciously making the record with the notion of like after this we're done, but I think there might have been a sense that they were finishing up. So there's definitely a whole other level of creativity in all aspects of that record, the drumming, the guitar playing, the songwriting, all of the performances on that record that are just like 1,000 steps higher than the Let It Be sessions from a few months earlier. Right. So I don't know that it's the best bass playing he's done, but there's certainly, in terms of, you know, per capita key bass lines, you know, besides Something, besides I Want You, She's So Heavy, I mean, you go anywhere in the world and walk up on stage and go, anywhere in the world, you could be in Nepal, in a bar in Nepal, and get on stage with a band and play that song, and they're going to know what you're talking about, right? Mm-hmm. So certainly some of the most iconic bass lines, for sure. During the presentation, I'm going to break down some of the stuff in the medley. I think Sun King. Right? Mm-hmm. But then when he goes up to the F sharp chord, he still plays the high E. Right? This is the octave from this E to this E. But then when the chord goes up to F sharp, he stays on the E. You know, he doesn't move up to, he doesn't go up the octave. He stays. And that note being over both chords just ties the whole thing together. It makes those two chords sort of connected to each other even more, you know.
I've noticed that Paul does that. Okay, yeah. So he keeps the root of the chord the same while the chords change. Like on Fool on the Hill. It's the same note while the chord goes up, you know.
Right.
I know some music theory here, so
good. Okay. Yeah. Good. So I'm not using the jargon isn't getting lost on you. Yeah, I mean it's definitely one of my favorite bass albums. I think, you know, like we said before, the earlier stuff is not quite as inventive, but it's the early stuff is no less important. I mean, the little lick that he does on the word. You know, every time he throws that in, I'm just like, oh, you know. Well, why don't we do it in the road? The last time through, like, what does he do? Are you in the road? You know, he'll throw in this little lick, but it's so sassy, and he waits to put it just in the right place where it doesn't step on anything. You know, mm-hmm. he waits for a space in the vocal phrase. You know what I mean? So that you notice it. But it also enhances whatever else is going on. It doesn't take away from the vocal, you know. He's always thinking about the full picture of the music. So whenever he gets his little licks in, it's still within the context of the entire picture, and it enhances it rather than distracts you from it. Certainly by Abbey Road by 69. I mean, all of them had evolved as players, and the four of them had evolved as a unit in the studio. So, you know, is it the best bass album? You know, then it's also the best drumming album. I mean, the drumming on that record is iconic. The guitar leads on that album are iconic. I think that there are plenty of cool bass lines on Rubber Soul. Pepper is loaded with killer bass stuff.
Right.
But there's something about the bass playing on Abbey Road that's like there's another layer to it. I don't know. I've heard varying stories. We all have about whether or not they knew that was going to be the last record. So I don't know if there was an extra sense of like, let's really go for it here, or maybe it was the kind of thing where I guess Let It Be, you know, the Get Back sessions had kind of like tapered off and like sort of ended not in such a good way that they thought, well, let's go in here and, you know, be good boys and, you know, do the right thing. Mm-hmm. So I hope that answers your question. I got to work on preparing like answers to these questions that don't go on for 25 minutes.
You're doing fine.
I'm sorry, Ken.
That's all right. Any final questions, guys?
No, I found the whole, just the second half of the show today, just fascinating. Sitting back and listening. And then, of course, when it comes to the solo stuff, as soon as this is done, I'll think of about 15 songs that I love.
Right.
We're picking songs and discussing them, I'm drawing a complete blank on everything.
Yep.
But
Mrs. Vanderbilt. Mrs. Vanderbilt.
Oh, yeah.
Great bass playing there.
Right.
Yeah.
And I think he played something pretty wild and more smooth than the Grey Goose, too. But I can't for the life of me now that I'm trying to think of it. But anyway, it was a very fascinating presentation, and I can't wait to see it in person with visuals.
Oh, you're going to be at the fest.
I'm like wallpaper at the fest.
Okay. Well, it's going to be on the Saturday afternoon. Mark Lapidus tells me sometime before 3 p.m.
Sure. Well, I hope it's not on the same time we have our panel.
Yeah, so do I, actually.
Have to talk to Al about that, I guess.
Okay.
John Montagna has been our special guest here. He will be at the fest for Beatle fans. Are you there all 3 days or just on the Saturday?
No, I'm subbing for Glenn Burtnick on the Friday night.
Okay.
With Liverpool. I guess Friday night is the dance party.
Right.
I think it's called. Yeah. Okay. So I'm going to be playing with Liverpool on the Friday night. And then Saturday I'm doing the bass workshop.
And okay. One quick thing unrelated to the Beatles. You were at the top of the show, we were talking about you having worked with Alan Parsons. You're on two albums, if I'm not mistaken, right?
I'm on
one studio and one live record, the last studio album of Ballad Path.
No. I'm only the only recorded work with Alan that I did was live. We did a show in Madrid. In May of 2004, we did a show at the Plaza Mayor in Madrid, and it was this huge outdoor thing with like 12,000 people, and it was broadcast on Spanish television. And Alan got a hold of the video footage, the raw video footage, and the raw audio. It turns out they'd done a multi-track recording, and he did a mix and put it out as Alan Parsons Live in Madrid, and it's been re-released a few times.
Right.
You know, the live in Madrid thing, but I never did have the pleasure to, be in the studio with him. Although having him as a band leader, I got a sense of his production genius. We were learning a Valid Path had just come out when we had just started playing with him. So we had to learn those songs. And there was one song where he made like a very sort of what I thought was a minor suggestion, like, oh, the second time through, play that down the octave, play it an octave lower, and then, you know, bring it down in an octave. And I went, all right. I thought, like, well, this isn't going to do anything. And it completely shifted the entire picture of the music. And I thought, oh my God, he's a genius. That's a producer to think to just make one little tiny tweak that you think isn't going to make any difference at all. And it completely shifts the entire picture. So that, you know, I feel like I was fortunate to have that experience too. And I just saw them when they came through New York. They played the Paramount Theater in November, and I went and saw them, and I got to hang out with those guys. And they're still rocking the current live project.
Yeah, well, I'm looking forward to seeing them March 1st in Tarrytown.
Oh yeah.
Oh yes. I'm going to see them also in New Jersey. I forget where exactly, but it's before Tarrytown.
Okay. I think.
All right.
Yeah. And so, as we said, John will be at the Fest for Beatle Fans on the Friday and Saturday. It actually takes place the whole weekend of March 29th through the 31st. And if you want more information about the Fest, you can just go to their website, which is thefest.com. I also want to very quickly plug one of the greatest concerts I've been to, which is called the Concert for Bangladesh Revisited with the band Wondrous Stories. Right. And John has been a part of that. I know you were there last year. For anyone that doesn't know, the band Wondrous Stories, which is a progressive rock, classic rock band on Long Island, they recreate the whole concert for Bangladesh. They do every single song that was done, except the long piece that Ravi Shankar did. that's tough to recreate there. But they do all the Bob Dylan stuff, Leon Russell. And the entire concert is about 3 hours. It's tremendous. They not only do that concert, but they do a whole bunch of other Beatles stuff and George Harrison music in particular. And and John was there last year, and they had Denny Lane as a special guest and Steve Holly. They had the Weaklings there as well as special guests. So that's going to take place March the 2nd.
at the Space in Westbury, Long Island. You want to just add something to that, John? Because I was so impressed with what I saw.
It's a really huge labor of love for all of us, because it's what's interesting is it's by any other standard, it's a logistical nightmare to get that many musicians in one place to show up on time, to be mindful of everyone else's space on stage and off, that many musicians, that many egos, that many parade floats all in one place could be a real disaster. And every year we come together just for the love of that music. And it's always a fun time. It's Wondrous Stories plus what I like to call the Wondrous Stories Auxiliary, which includes myself, Ed Ryan, is a handful of great musicians, Frank Walker, Tommy Bowes, who's a singer that worked with Tower Power for a little while. We've got a horn section, there's a vocal choir. Steve Holly, like you said, is going to be sitting in on drums with us on a few things. A couple of other star guests, as they say in England, are going to be popping in, whose names I'm blanking on right now. Yeah. But yeah, we start with the Bangladesh concert sort of as the springboard, and then we go from there into like other, you know, Beatles related stuff. And like Ken said, it goes on sometimes like for 3 hours, and it's a huge event, and it's a lot of fun, and there's a lot of love in that room. And I'm looking forward to it again.
And you mentioned Ed Ryan, who is not only a tremendous singer and songwriter and performer, but when I first started doing my Beatles show on Long Island on college radio, New York Tech, he was my co-host. That's how I got to know him.
That doesn't surprise me. That guy really doesn't. He needs to learn how to come out of his shell a little bit.
Yeah, right.
I'm waiting for you to play the man from Pipes of Peace and dedicate it to him.
I've done that on the air.
Okay, good.
And I also want to compliment John, because when I saw the concert last year, one of the George Harrison solo songs that he did, thumbs up to you, John, Someplace Else. Excellent job on that song.
Oh, thank you.
Yeah, very thank nice.
You. Okay. I gotta push the Cloud Nine stuff on people, you know?
In fact, John was a guest on my show, Every Little Thing, and we had a little debate as to whether or not, what was the better album, All Things Must Pass or Cloud Nine. So if you want to listen, actually, you can hear the whole interview on my website on kenmichaelsradio.com. You'll hear us throwing pots and pans at each other during the interview. But otherwise, we have a very robust conversation about it.
Yep.
So before we go, why don't we give everybody our contact information? We'll start with you, John, because you have a website, right?
Yes. Everything and everything you want to know about me and what I'm doing is on my website, johnmontagna.com. I'm on Instagram at John Montagna. I'm on Twitter at John Mon, J-O-N-M-O-N. And the Facebook page, I think, is John Montagna Fans. But I'm on Facebook as a civilian as well. So, you know, you can find me there, too. But everything goes on the website.
Okay.
So if you don't mind, can I plug something else real quick, Ken?
The podcast show?
My band, Montagna Band, is going to be playing at the Groove on Thursday, March 7th at 7:30 p.m.
And that's where?
That's in the Groove is at 125 McDougal Street in the heart of New York's Greenwich Village. That's my original band. And that's it. My original band.
Still together.
Thursday, March 7th. Yeah. 7:30 p.m. at the Groove.
Okay, great. Darren, how about you?
All right. You can reach me at the WFUV email address is Darren DeVivo, DarrenDeVivo at WFUV.org. And the Facebook page, if you're interested, come by and like Darren DeVivo on WFUV Radio. It's the full name of the page.
All right, Alan, how about you?
I'm pretty easy, just Alan Kozinn or Alan Kozinn Remixed on Facebook.
And our contact information, since you're so good with it, Alan.
Oh, okay. Okay, I'll do a dramatic reading of our contact. You can contact us at Things We Said Today Radio Show at gmail.com, and you can follow us on Twitter at Things We Said Fab. We also have a Facebook page, Things We Said Today, Beatles Radio Fans.
Okay. All right. You're doing that better and better every single show, Alan.
Yeah. Oh, I've been practicing, you know, when we're not on.
I can tell. I can tell. And I do want to announce a few things. This is really exciting. A special contest happening on my website, and it's called, get this, the World of Ken Contest. You asked me what that's all about. I'm giving away three prizes in one bundle, all from guys named Ken. That includes Ken Womack's new book, Sound Pictures. That's the second volume of his biography on George Martin. Ken Mansfield, who we just had on our show, the former U.S. manager for Apple Records. His book is called The Roof, The Beatles' Final Concert. And then there's me. Every week on my website, on my trivia page, there's nine prizes. Someone always wins one of those nine prizes every single week. You get to pick one of those nine prizes. So you win three prizes all in one shot. My World of Ken contest, which starts this Thursday on my website. Right on the homepage, it'll take you right to my special contest page, so be sure to check that out. And also, last week I had the pleasure of interviewing Elliot Mintz, who we had on our show not too long ago. We covered a few things that were covered in this show with some other questions that I threw at him. He was such a joy to talk to. Wow. We did a bit more talking about the Lost Lennon tapes, and if you want to check that out, it's on my interviews page 4 page, which I believe also has my interview with John on there. So that's all on my website at kenmichaelsradio.com. Okay, I think that's everything.
Are guests from the show exempt from winning the prizes?
Not at all.
Okay.
Not at all.
You got the wildlife box on there?
No.
Okay.
It's very tough to get box sets to give away, believe me.
Oh, okay. All right.
I'm working on it, though. I'm always working on whatever new products are out there.
Sure.
All right. So this has been great, John. And
my pleasure. Oh, thank you for having me. I really appreciate it.
Yeah, thanks for doing this, John.
It's a lot of
fun.
And
thanks for coming with your bass setup. That was really helpful.
I kind of knew that, like, once I started talking about this stuff, I said, at some point, I'm going to have to grab an instrument to demonstrate. So I'm glad that the technology I was able to work it out, getting it all into Skype and all that business.
Okay. Well, this has been great, and we could have talked even longer, but I think almost 2 hours should just about cover it, don't you think?
I think so. I think if people choose to listen to all of the 2 hours, then that's even more daring.
All right. So thanks so much for being here, John, and for Alan and Darren. And John Montagna, our special guest. This is Ken Michaels thanking all of you for listening. And we will see you next time.